In today's Excel VBA video, I'm going to show you the different ways you can write to a range or to different cells in Excel. We're going to use range, cells property, offset, define names, and in addition, I'm also going to cover how you can refer to entire rows, entire columns, and also use autofit. This video is brought to you by Unlock Excel VBA and Macros course, where you're going to learn how to simplify your work and how to save time by automating complex and routine tasks. We're going to go from beginner all the way to advanced. For more information, check out the description of this video or go to xelplus.com/courses. Find out more about the course at the end of this video. You might be surprised at all the different methods available, but each has their own set of advantages. A lot of these advantages are going to become more clear once you learn about looping in VBA. This is a file that's available inside the course, but you can just open up any empty Excel file and follow along with me. It's going to be fun. Let's do this. Let's bring up the Visual Basic Editor by using the shortcut key Alt F11 and add a new module. So just right mouse click and insert a module. I'm going to call it Lessons Ranges. Okay, so I have option explicit here by default. I covered this briefly in a previous lecture. At the moment right now, it's not important if you have it or not. Okay, so if you don't have it, you can just leave it out. I'm going to create a new sub procedure by just typing in sub and I'll call it refer to cells. Press enter, the brackets and end sub come by default. Before we start, let's clarify one thing, and that's the difference between active cell and selection. Let me snap in the Visual Basic Editor here so we can view the Excel file and the editor at the same time and collapse this as well. I'm going to use the immediate window to do a test. If you don't have immediate window activated, you can do it by going to View, Immediate Window. Okay, so now I'm going to put a question mark and type in activecell.address. So that's a property of the active cell object. I'm going to press enter. What do you think I'm going to get? A1, right? What if I do selection.address? What will I get? Also A1. Now let me highlight this. What am I going to get for activecell.address? C4. Okay, just one cell, and that's the one that's highlighted a bit differently here. What about this? The full range, right? So that's the difference. Active cell and selection are also liked by the macro recorder, so you might have recognized it from there. It's something that I don't use that often when I'm writing to cells. I try to avoid these methods, and instead I try to refer to cells using range and cells properties. Okay, so let's have a look at a few of these. One way is to use the range property. I could say range, and you have to use the quotation marks and put in A1. So I'm referencing the column and the row number dot value equals. So value is a property of the range. It's the default property. So even if I leave it out, it will pick dot value as the property. I'm going to type in the text first, and since this is just normal text, I have to put it in quotation marks. And notice that I haven't mentioned the workbook here, I haven't mentioned the worksheet here. So which workbook and worksheet is this going to assume? The active one, right? So whatever I have active here, and I have this one active. So if you're following along, make sure you have the correct one active, otherwise you're going to write to a different file. I'm going to test this. I'm going to press play and it puts first in range A1. Another way I can write this is to use the cells property. It's the property of the active sheet and also the property of the range object. If I type in cells 1, 1, I haven't mentioned the range here, so it's going to assume the active sheet dot cells 1, 1, and I say equals. I'm not going to say dot value here because the default property for this one is also value, and type in first. Now just to see it, let me remove this one And let me comment this one out. So the code will only run this line. I'm going to press play and it puts first here. That's another way of writing two cells. I'm going to bring it here and comment it out here. Now, what if I do something like this? Where am I going to get this second? So let's check in all of these cells, right? So it's A2 till C2, and you need that colon and those quotation marks. And now what if I do something like this? I have split these two different ranges with a comma. Okay, so think about, where will I see this third? Let's check. Okay, I see it from A to C. D, there's nothing. Okay, so that's the split, and then E and F. Now let's try another one. Range A4. Now check this out. I'm not gonna put the colon, I'm gonna put a comma, C4. Okay, so what am I gonna get here? Only in A, only in C, nothing in B. If I wanted something in B, I can write it in this way, but there's also another way of writing this. Putting the quotation marks like this, and the comma, and then the quotation marks again. So we're on fifth. Notice here the difference between this and this. I'm gonna press play, and it puts it in the middle as well. Okay, so it's really important that you use the quotation marks properly to get the result that you want. So take some time to take a look at the differences here and the result that you get here. Yet another way of writing this is to reference the column like this and combine it with the row number with an and sign. Okay, so if I do A6 and then we do C and 6 here. The reason you need the and sign is like pretty much the same as when you write Excel formulas. Whenever you're combining text with numbers or text with cell references, you always need that and sign. You need that in VBA as well. And we're going to type in 6 here. What will we get here? We get it the same way like we had in here. Now, the reason you would do this is when you learn about looping and if you want to go through many different rows, because this is going to be a variable that's going to change. Sometimes you want it to be 6, sometimes 7, 8, 9, 10, and so on. And that's why you would split it in this way. We get to that later on. Another way that you can write this is this. We use the cells property of the range object and we say 6, 1, and 6, 3, okay, because 6 is the row here, okay, so it's the other way around, and 1 is the column here. In case we ever need to loop through many different columns and different rows, it makes sense to refer to them by numbers. Okay, so I'm gonna just take this one out, delete this, and let's run this, and you get the same thing here. Let's put this as a comment there. So what about this one? We're using the cells property of the range object. Where would the seventh come in? So instead of highlighting one cell here, I'm highlighting a range, and then inside the range, I'm referencing cells 4, 2. Okay, so let's press play, and let's see what we get. We get B7. So let's think about this. We have A4 to C7 highlighted, so that's this range. And inside this range, we want cells 4, 2. So let's count. First is the rows 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. We end up here. Another way now is to use the offset property. So let's say I do range A1 dot offset. And we saw this before when we used the macro recorder. And we use the relative referencing. 7, 2 dot value, and I'm gonna type in 8th here. Okay, so where am I gonna get the 8th? Let's try right here. Why does it do that? Range A1, I'm offsetting 7, so it starts to count from here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 2, 1, 2, I end up here. If you remember, in the example where we use the relative referencing to record our macro, It used the offset property as well, but then it did something strange. Right after offset, it typed in range A1.value or range A1.select. So something like this, right? It can be very confusing, but let me just run this. So let me delete this one. Let me run this and we get the value there. But we're super confused about why do we need to refer to this two times. Now, this is just the behavior of the macro recorder. And all this stands for is that we're selecting one cell in the end. If I put in something like A1 to, let's put A4, okay, let's see what we get. Four cells, right? So that's pretty much what the macro recorder was doing. It was only using this reference, meaning it's just one cell, right? So you don't need it. If you're recording macros, you can easily remove that range A1 reference and just go with dot select. Okay, so now it would make sense. Let me just add a clear one to this so that we clear all the results before we write new ones. For that, I can just put in cells.clear. Okay, because that's the active sheet is assumed. So active sheet.cells.clear. And I'm going to run this, deletes everything, and then it runs through the macro. You can also offset a range. So instead of offsetting one cell, you can have a range. So something like this. I'm starting off with this range and I'm offsetting by 8 and one column. Okay, so let's see what we get. A1 to B1, and then I'm offsetting the whole thing by 8. So I move down here and 1. Okay, so I move here. So basically my range was here and the whole thing was offset by this value. Last one is to use the name manager names that you give. So for example, let's say this cell here, I'm going to bookmark it or give it a name called last one. And I'm going to do this by going to the name box here and typing in the name and pressing enter. Okay, so I've given this cell this name. Now I can reference that name in the range address. And to do that, you have to put it in quotation marks as well. Let's do this as our last one. That's the 10th. Okay, so when I click this, it writes 10th here. Now, the advantage of this is that it's not a specific cell reference. If I bring it here, see, last one has moved here. I'm going to step into the code actually so that we can see it clear. To do that, just click anywhere inside your code and press F8. This way, you can go line by line. And you press F8, you move to the next line. So now we cleared the cells and we're moving and we're typing these in. Then if I press play, it just runs through the rest of the code. And we can see that 10th has moved down here. If you don't want to use the shortcut key when you're debugging, you can go to debug and you can step into from here. I'm going to move this now back to here. Okay, so quickly, let's have a look at how we can also reference entire rows or columns. If I type in rows, I'm gonna do, let's say, 12 till 14. Now notice I need the quotation marks because I have colons in there, right? So that's considered text. Now I don't wanna write to an entire row, so I'm gonna use the row height property and set this to 30. Okay, so that's 12 till 14. So the row height should get bigger. Let's go like this. Yeah, we can see that expanded. One way to refer to separate rows is like this. This way, we're just referring to 16, 18, and 20. So we're skipping 17 and 19. Okay, so let's check that out. Okay, we can see that 17 and 19 were skipped here. Now, what about columns? It's the same concept. I'm going to put it in quotation marks, use E2F, so that's the entire column, and say dot column width, and let's set this to 10. Okay, so that's E2F. I'm going to press play. Okay, so that expanded a little bit. And the same way you can refer to different columns as well, like this or like this. Okay, so let's see what these do. Let's press play. Okay, so H and then j.columnWidth is 10. So this means it's only the h column and only the j column that have a column width of 10. And when I refer to these like this, like columns 1, 3, column width is 5. So again, this is the first column to the third column. If you want to auto-fit all your columns, you can do cells.columns.autofit, and that's gonna make sure everything is fitted properly. So these are the different ways that you can refer to cells. I've summarized them for you on one slide, so make sure you go through them and you understand the difference, especially when it comes to the quotation marks, right? So for these cases where we have the quotation marks like this and when we have it like this, so really understand this difference here and spend some time to get familiar with the syntax. We also took a look at different ways that we can reference entire rows and columns. Okay, so in this case, we changed the row height, the column width, and we used the autofit. Since in your projects, you're mostly going to be working with ranges, in the next lecture, I'm going to take you through the most common range properties and methods that you're going to need for your projects. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, I'd appreciate it if you gave it a thumbs up. If you're interested to find out more about my Excel VBA course, check out the link in the description below. If you'd like to learn about Excel, formulas, visualization, dashboards, check out the videos on my channel. And if you like what you see, consider subscribing.